Right, so if we ignore everything that happened in the last section, and moving on, so we've got these males that are cheating, and this is what females want, but what do males want? Well, males want lots of sex. It's kind of obvious, but the problem is that you've got lots of males wanting lots of sex, and the females not necessarily wanting so much, then all of this harassment is going to build up with all these horny males wanting to shag all these females. And this can be a real problem for the females. And so we get this sexual harassment. And I've got a funny anecdote about sexual harassment. It's a line you probably didn't expect to hear me say coming out to the Royal Institution this evening. But I do, so I'm going to go with it. So I was presenting on a pilot for a kids' TV program earlier this year. And so I had a load of four-year-olds with me. And we were also going pond dipping, kids and animals. It was always going to go well. And my producer decides, okay, wouldn't it be great if we could show them some frogs? Because frogs are cool. They are. They're great. I love talking about frogs. But I'm not going to do that now. And they think, okay, we can't rely on finding any frogs in this school pond. So maybe if we can find some beforehand, bring them in and pretend that we found them, because everything you see on TV is a lie. And so we rang around, really, really struggled to find some frogs, but thank goodness someone at the school found some, popped them in a pot from her pond, brought them into the school the next day. And it was great, and I opened the pot, and they were frogs. They weren't toads, they were actual frogs. Problem was, this was back in February. No one here knows the frog reproductive life cycle, okay? One person does, there we go. See the rest, see if we can catch on then. So she'd managed to find two frogs. She'd managed to find a male and a female frog who at the time were loving each other very much and giving each other a special cuddle. And I had to present these mating frogs to a load of four-year-olds. I don't know what to do, so I'm trying to separate the male from the female. And the trouble is, they have this vice-like grip. The males have this reflex called amplexus, which means that they tighten the more you try and pull them off. And they do this because the females, if they grab onto a female, they don't want another male to kind of kick him off. It's like, no, she's mine. But they're so selfish in squeezing that they sometimes end up drowning the female frog because they prevent her from getting to the surface. Or they just downright strangle her to death. And no one wants to mate with a dead frog. So in being selfish and getting the selfish benefits, everybody suffers. And this is a case of the tragedy of the commons, and it comes up everywhere. But rather than tell you about the tragedy of the commons, you may have noticed that I'm slightly different to your normal science speaker. So I am instead going to teach you about the tragedy of the commons through the medium of a rave. Get your dancing moves ready, everybody. So, I know, there we go, we've got some dancing going on. Keep going. Nice little boogie in your seats. So, I'm going to transport you all from the Royal Institution Faraday Theatre to Wembley Arena, because I want to be a rock goddess and I'm going to force you to live out my fantasies. And I am putting on the best show you possibly could imagine. And right now, you're in the best position you could possibly be. This is the optimal, this is the best. Because you're all sitting down, you're nice and comfy, but you've all got a great view. So this is best. But then we have our selfish individual, David here, who, I mean, he's just such a fan, you know? And he's so overcome with emotion. This is such a great gig that the emotion just overcomes him and he just has to get a better view and he can't control his dancing. So he stands up just to get a better view. I say where you are, sir, and just keeps on dancing away. And keep going. But now, no, say where you are. This will be very important. Because now the people behind you can't see because David's blocking the way. And so now they all have to stand up because they're great fans. The next row, stand up and start dancing. This is a great, great party going. There we go. But now the row behind you can't see anything. So they have to get up and start dancing. And all the people behind you are all such big fans that you just have to see me. So you all end up standing up and dancing. There we go. Oh, standing ovation for me. Oh, you shouldn't have. Oh, that's so kind. So now, you can see that because you've all been acting selfishly, you've ended up in a worse position. You can all see exactly the same as you could before, assuming your sitting height and your standing height are pretty much proportional. But now you're all standing up, which isn't half as fun. So this just this is a tragedy of the commons situation, and I'll let you all now sit down and start with all my fantasies. But you get the idea, and the tragedy of the commons comes up everywhere. You get it with overfishing, you get it with air pollution, and you could say you get it with sex as well, because you get these males acting selfishly. And so this can create an awful lot of sexual conflict between males and females. And if you want to see the extent of sexual conflict in animals, then I suggest you search for explosive aversion of a duck penis on YouTube. I also suggest that you turn incognito mode on first, unless you want a search history that is as sordid as mine, and really, I don't know what my network provider thinks I do. Also, I checked this last night. It's had 1 million views. I study sex. I have a reason to be looking at this kind of thing, but what everyone else is up to, I don't know. But the trouble is that we've been going through this, and I've almost been lying to you. There's a problem with what we've been saying. And as you gasp in horror, it's time for another music break.